I actually almost gave up at that point. No BS, this is still one of my proudest accomplishments. At the time, I could count on my fingers how many people there were in the entire world that could do this trick. But if there's one exception to that rule, it's gonna be this trick. Drex here from DrexFactor Poi, bringing you the love of poi spinning and flow arts to benefit your body and brain. And today, I'm continuing this month's theme of Inside Drex's Brain by talking about the 10 poi tricks that made me as a spinner. Before we dive in, I just want to give a quick shout out to the friends of the channel. Big thanks to Dark Monk, Flow DNA, Flow Fests, Flow Toys, Juggling Calling, Pyroterra Light Toys, Spin Balls, and Ultrapoi for helping to make the videos on this channel possible. You can learn more about all these amazing companies and the work that they're doing to support flow artists like yourself by checking out the links that I've got down in the description of this video. I have learned a lot of poi tricks in my day, so many that I've actually forgotten a lot of them. But there have been a select few that have had a huge and long-lasting impact on me as a poi spinner, and today, I'm going to take a little trip down memory lane to talk about some of the more important ones. Looking back on it, I'd love to share with you some of the most important tricks I've learned over the years and why they were so important. What it was they taught me, whether they became important to my own personal style, and insights I got as a result of learning them. So here they are presented in the order that I learned them in. Number 10, reels. The first poi trick I ever learned. I got back from Burning Man 2006, having seen fire dancing for the first time, and I was chomping at the bit to learn it. I asked around for months, trying to find out if I had any friends who even knew what it was called, before someone finally told me that our friend Paul knew how to spin poi, and he was willing to teach me. I showed up at his house for my first lesson and spent 2 hours trying to learn a basic reel. But try as I might, I could not wrap my head around how the poi would switch from being on both sides of the body to being on only one. I kept getting my hand and poi caught behind me. I actually almost gave up at that point, until my roommate at the time gifted me with a set of poi that he'd bought on holiday in Thailand, and I redoubled my efforts. But this is still that trick that stands out in my mind as the one that started it all. Number 9, the 4-beat fountain. This is a story that's come up again recently, but the 4-beat fountain was really the first poi trick that I learned that made what poi was all about click for me. Before this, every trick that I learned felt like its own discrete thing, like separate boxes sitting on the floor. Whenever I wanted to switch between different tricks, I usually just stopped spinning and then set myself up for the next trick. And the 4-beat fountain suddenly changed all that for me. I thought of it as a waist strap transitioning to a windmill, my very first poi combo. And boom, there was something that went off in my head, and I realized that all these different poi tricks weren't just haphazard entities unto themselves. You could flow between them. Truth be told, having this realization meant seeing that the pieces could all fit together. At first, this felt like Legos locking together, but as time has gone on, I think of this much more like mixing different colored paints to create a portrait. Sometimes they blur a little together, and sometimes they have very hard contrasts. And sometimes you can create unique shades of each color to fit a unique mood or composition. It's a beautiful way to think about spinning, and for me, it all harkens back to this one trick and what it taught me about flow. Number 8, corkscrews. So this one is kind of funky because I don't think I gave this trick a second thought for the better part of a decade, but it's now a staple of my own style. We never think about the importance of horizontal plane moves, at least not with any great frequency. So this first one is usually something of a curiosity that we then kind of put on the side and forget about. Sometimes for years. But when I made my hard left turn from tech to dance, I discovered that horizontal plane moves were suddenly really important. And all of a sudden, that corkscrew came out of mothballs, and it's now one of the most important tricks in my arsenal. Bottom line, no matter what you may think, no trick is truly insignificant. It can come back and be important in ways that you can't possibly imagine. Number 7, crossers. This trick was the absolute bane of my existence in the first 2 years of spinning. I saw friends doing it, and I thought it was one of the coolest things that I had ever seen. But I could also tell by watching it that it was going to require a lot of dedicated work over the course of several weeks to get down. and I did not want to put that work in. I even had a friend who showed me the steps I needed to practice in order to get there, which is still the method that I use for teaching it to this day. But finally, I decided to take the plunge and work through it step by step. It took weeks, and it was frequently really hard, but I felt such an amazing amount of accomplishment coming out of it. This was the first trick that I ever really fought for. It was the first trick that I truly had to learn discipline and long-term planning to get down, and those lessons have proven invaluable countless times since. Number 6. Behind the back weaves.
I hate doing this trick so much.
I originally learned it because I was on that path as a novice tech spinner of just learning all of the things. And after I got down crossers and flowers, it seemed like this was the next thing on the checklist. It's also really hard for me because my shoulders are not very flexible, and my arms are actually kind of short for my height. But that's not why it's important. You see, I actually had to learn another trick in order to get this one down. I had to learn how to do giants and learn to move from my body core in order to do the necessary pivoting from side to side that finally led me to getting the behind the back weave. See, this is the first time that I found my way to getting a trick by drilling a completely different skill. It was the first time I'd broken something down and found a kinesthetic skill that I needed to learn in order to get to the next step. And you know what? That's been the cornerstone of how I learn new tricks and teach them ever since. Number 5. Butterfly 1.5s. I moved to Washington, D.C. in February of 2008, and within a few months, I found other poi spinners to hang out with and learn from. And this was one of the first tricks that I learned from them. What made it so important? Well, two things. The first is that it was the topic of my very first tech blog video, years ago. That was the trick that launched this channel and started me on the path to becoming a content creator and online presence in the flow arts community. The second requires a bit of a story. I didn't actually share my videos when I first started posting them. Some people would find them organically because they were posted on YouTube, and then magically one day I woke up to discover that my first three videos had gotten a bunch of views, and I was baffled as to how. Turned out there was a discussion on the old Home of Poi forums about 1.5s, and my poi idol Alien John had shared my videos as an example of some of the different things you could do with 1.5s. Not only did this start the process of my building an audience, which I would never have tried to do myself, thanks John, but it also was the first time I'd become a part of a global conversation about movement in the flow arts. A conversation I got a lot more confident in as time went on, and that I still feel like I'm a part of to this very day. Number 4. The Mercedes. This is another trick from the same period as the Butterfly 1.5s, but this one had even longer ranging effects on me and my teaching. In June of 2008, there was a workshop series taught by the Vulcan crew that worked its way through Washington, D.C. In one of those workshops, I learned about linear extensions and linear isolations and how they could be used to drill tricks that could be broken down into straight lines. One such trick? The tri-catcher versus extension polyrhythm hybrid, which at the time was more commonly known as the Mercedes. Not only did those techniques help me to get down the Mercedes and later Zan's diamond by breaking it into smaller parts that could be more easily practiced, it also gave me access to one of the most important tools for teaching poi that I've ever been given access to. There are so many tricks later down the road that I was able to figure out by getting down linear extensions and linear isolations that I actually did an entire video on why these two tools are so incredibly important. I'll link to it down in the description. Number 3. Horizontal cat eye versus isolation. No BS, this is still one of my proudest accomplishments. So we're back in the halcyon days of 2009, and the tech poi world is abuzz over cat eyes. Alien John has made them the hottest trick in the poi world, and everybody wants to learn them. And crucially, there's a variation on them that Alien John has predicted, but has a reputation like a unicorn. People claim that their friend can do one, but nobody has yet seen it on video. After a couple performance videos from Yuta and Mel make the rounds, it's clear that not only do horizontal cat eyes exist, they can also be combined with isolations into an amazingly slick anti-brid. And learning that hybrid was the moment that I arrived as a tech spinner. At the time, I could count on my fingers how many people there were in the entire world that could do this trick. And as of my writing this, I'm still the only person in the DC area that can. Yeah, I'm still proud of this one. Number 2. One-handed Mercedes. This trick was the entire reason that I started learning meteor spinning or Ultrapoi one hand style spinning. And I don't think that I have ever been more frustrated or had to work harder for a trick in my entire life. Having to control the plane on the pinky and poi was something I never thought to do before, and it was a rough road. I lost count of the number of times I got so frustrated that I literally threw the poi against the ground. It took months and months, but it finally did happen, and Ultrapoi one hand is still a cornerstone of my style. This was an important moment that reminded me that as you learn more and more poi tricks, acquiring new ones frequently requires an even greater investment of time and energy. And the major benchmarks have more and more time between them. It's not necessarily a bad thing, but it was an important lesson for me for the long term. You never get to a point where you stop working hard in order to get new things. And trick number one, gunslinger anti-brids. I get asked every once in a while how many tricks I've invented, and my answer is actually usually zero. Everything, and I do mean everything I've learned in my 13 plus years spinning poi has come from something that I've seen someone else doing, and either I find a new variant on it, or I just put what they've done in front of more eyeballs. I've never thought of myself as an innovator, I've always been more of an educator. But if there's one exception to that rule, it's gonna be this trick. This was just straight up a holy crap moment that I had while playing around with gunslingers and realized that they have equivalents to traditional anti-spin flowers. We'd already seen this at work with six petal gunslinger versus isolation, but it had never been applied to the more common 10 petal gunslinger variant. And honestly, to this day, I've never actually seen another poi spinner do it. Not on video, not in person. It might be the one and only trick in my 13 years as a poi spinner that I could claim to have actually invented. And you know what? I'm cool with that, because I love this trick. So those were 10 poi tricks that made me the spinner that I am today. Which one was your favorite? Be sure to like, comment, share, and subscribe to help other people find this video and to help my channel grow. I also just want to put out a huge thank you because this video would not be possible without the kind contributions of these wonderful people right here. These are my Flow patrons on Patreon, and they, along with the wonderful people listed down in the description, make this video and all the videos on my channel possible. If you'd like to help me out in my mission to bring poi spinning and flow arts to the wider world and help people learn to be creative with their bodies, you can do so by heading over to patreon.com/drexfactorpoi and signing up. You can get early access to all of my content, a say in what topics I tackle in the future, plus some behind the scenes and extra content as well. So go check that out. Please and thank you. What were the tricks that were most important to your evolution as a poi spinner? Leave me a comment and let me know. Are there other tricks you associate with me or that I taught you? I'd love for you to share them with me. Make sure to get outside and get in some flow. Connect with your body and give your brain a break, and I will see you on Friday with a new video. For now, have a good one. Peace.